For our lesson today, we are going to be looking at one particular verse in Genesis chapter 3, the 15th verse. But to get there, we've got to do some foreground work. You can hardly get much more background than Genesis chapter 3. We'll look at the foreground. I think it has something very important for us to tell us. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 through 57. Here the Apostle Paul, when he's talking about the gospel, to begin with, the first few verses of 1 Corinthians 15, he gets into the second coming of Christ and the resurrection. But he ends that great chapter with these words: "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin." And pause there for just a moment, and let me rephrase that. The snake bite of death is sin. And the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The reason that we live in corruptible bodies, mortal bodies that will die, is simply because as the human race, we have been denied access to the tree of life. We looked at that when we talked about Genesis chapter 2, how that when God created man, he created man on purpose and for a purpose. But when we get into Genesis chapter 3, we find that man did not fulfill his purpose. He did not honor God by keeping God's word. Again, we go back to Genesis chapter 2, and we find that there were two trees planted in the Garden of Eden. One was the tree of life, that if man would eat of that tree of life, he'd continue to live. There would not be death, because God didn't purpose us to death. But there was another tree that was there, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and I suggested last week we probably should call that the tree of sin and death, that once they ate of that tree, they began to die. Sin entered into the human race, and we might say into the human psyche. So it's that instant that we become corruptible bodies, mortal, because in a sense, the minds of human beings were corrupted at that point. Corrupted by not obeying God, but by choosing, and that's why there are two trees there. We don't have freedom if we don't have a choice. We can't say we've been obedient to God unless we have the choice to be disobedient. So with that tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, by partaking of that fruit, sin and death is introduced into the human realm, the human sphere. That's why we have corrupted bodies. That's why we have mortal bodies. And that causes a lot of problems then, because after that point, see, most of the time we're not looking at things in a spiritual way. We look at things in physical, material, carnal ways. Because this body is corruptible, sometimes I might have to fight for food. I might have to kill somebody for food. All those things that come in with sin and death, pride. It was what John talks about. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life have destroyed human beings. But we have a promise. We have a promise that one day we can be, or regain access to the tree of life. But we have to do something that our ancient ancestors, Adam and Eve, did not do at the very first, at the very beginning, and that was to honor God and obey God. So if we will honor God and obey God in our lives, then these corruptible bodies that we have, when they put on incorruption, when these mortal bodies put on immortality, if we have believed and obeyed, if we know God and obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, then we will have access once again to the tree of life. God made three promises, not only to Adam and Eve and to the devil in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, there are three promises really to us as human beings and as ancestors, descendants of Adam and Eve, but hopefully also to be born again and to be descendants of God, the children of God, disciples of Jesus Christ. So what we want to do is look at these three promises and see how that these things occurred when Adam and Eve failed to trust and obey God. And the first promise comes in the very first part of Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15. And I will put enmity between you and the woman. He's talking to the serpent. The Satan had entered into the serpent, deceived Eve. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. Listen, most women don't like snakes, but that's not what this is about. Okay? This is enmity between the devil and the woman, and especially in the sense between your seed, Satan's seed, and her seed, that's Christ. And those who follow Christ, those who are adopted into God's family because they know God and obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because of what Adam and Eve did, mankind lives in a state of perpetual enmity. And what's enmity? You can see the word enemy in there, can't you? It's just in there. It's in the word. They're enemies. Well, instead of Adam and Eve and then their family growing up, everybody's in kind of like what they talked about in the 60s, see, the brotherhood of man. It became enemies of one another. Men and women fight. That's what the election's all about coming up, right? If you listen to some of the news channels, that's what the election's all about. No, but there's struggles between the two. Husbands and wives, there's struggles. Say, parents and children, there's struggles. People within communities, there's struggles. That's where this all originated from, because the knowledge of good and evil. As God was teaching Adam and Eve good when he walked with them in the Garden of Eden, that sudden shock of evil and knowing evil was more than they could stand, and it's more than we can stand, in the sense that because of our carnal nature, we desire to disobey God. We desire not to live at peace at all times. We desire to keep things stirred up. Look at how it plays out in history. Cain hated Abel and killed him. Genesis chapter 4. Now I won't dwell too much on that, because of the pattern goes right. Next week we'll look at some things in Genesis chapter 4. But 1 John chapter 3 verse 12, John the apostle of love tells us why this happened. And why did he murder him? Why did Cain murder Abel? Because Cain's works were evil and his brothers were righteous. And nobody likes a righteous person. Jesus said that if we try to live right, we're going to be persecuted. That's repeated throughout the scriptures. But that's why. It's because of this enmity, this war between the forces of Satan and God's forces, led by His Son. And the book of Revelation shows us the one who rides out on the white horse, leading His armies into not physical battle, but spiritual battle. Jesus affirms this in Matthew chapter 12, verse 30. He said, "He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters abroad." If we're not on the same page with God, if we're not fighting with Jesus Christ against the forces of evil, we're on the wrong side. But we're fighting against God. And you can't fight against God and win. There is no neutrality in this world. So how does it play out today? Again, James chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. Very important passage sometimes that we don't pay a whole lot of attention to. But it talks about this enmity. "Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures." What's that mean? It's lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, pride of life. Those are the things we fight for. Those are things that we want and desire, and we'll destroy people to get them. And that comes directly from the fall of man in the Garden of Eden. Verse 4, adulterers and adulteresses. And he's not talking about physical, he's talking about spiritual adulterers and adulteresses. "Do you not know that friendship with the world is," there's that word, "enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God." James says, here's where it comes from, right back in the garden. Right back here, when Adam and Eve did not honor God, they disobeyed God. It sets the whole human race in this state of enmity. Not only were they separated from God, they were separated from each other. And as human beings, we're still back until we have that new birth. And we make that decision and that commitment. I'm not going to do the works of the flesh anymore. That's not going to be what drives me. I want to be a spiritually minded person. See, there was a warning that Paul gives from God to the churches in Galatia, Galatians chapter 5, verse 15. Paul says, "If you bite and devour one another, beware lest you are consumed by one another." Yes, the works of the flesh will have us consume one another. But that's the war. That's the battle that we're engaged in. And it's not, I've got to impose my will upon somebody else. The concept is, wouldn't it be great if we can get God's will into the lives of people so that we can have peace and not that enmity that God promised would happen because of what Adam and Eve had done. So, there's going to be enmity, but the second promise, it is great, and it's a promise of a deliverer, someone who can take that away. And it's when God talks about the seed of the woman. Now, if you look in most of your translations, that word seed, the S will be capitalized because it's talking about one seed. It's talking about one person who's going to come. Everywhere you look in the Bible, when it talks about seed or descendants, it's talking about the seed of man or the descendant of man. Most of the genealogies that we find, this man begat this man, who begat this man, who begat this man, all the way down through. But the break that you have is the seed of the woman. When Mary, as a virgin, brings forth that seed who is the Son of God, the Word who became flesh and dwelt among us. We'll talk more about that in a moment. But this is the first prophecy of Christ in the Bible. There are other prophecies. He would be a descendant of Abraham, or the seed of Abraham, Genesis chapter 22 and verse 18. He'd be the seed of Judah, Genesis chapter 49, verse 10. Born of a virgin, Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. And yes, it says Alma there, but in the New Testament, in both Matthew and Luke's account, you find that's a virgin, a woman who's known no man, has never had sexual relations. That's a miracle. That's a miracle beyond comprehension. You see, it wasn't the birth of Jesus that was so much miraculous as the conception was miraculous. No man involved. The seed of the woman. And then Isaiah chapter 53 talks about the sacrificial death. You can't read Isaiah chapter 53 and have read about Jesus dying on the cross and not see Jesus dying on the cross in Isaiah chapter 53. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 6. The seed of the woman is also a descendant of Abraham. Not on the male side when you get down to the end, but Mary was a descendant of Abraham. Paul goes on, he says, he does not say unto seeds as of many, but as of one, to your seed, who is Christ. Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, Abraham, Jacob, and not only Jacob, but you go on down to David, Solomon, and those descendants, to redeem those who are under the law, that's Jews, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Now, Paul was a Jew, but yet he's talking to Gentiles. And the Gentiles even have a hope. The Gentiles even have a deliverer. Someone to deliver from that curse that brought enmity between God and man and between men on this earth. So Jesus Christ, the Word of God who became a human being, is our deliverer. He is our Savior. He is God who came as a human being to deliver us from the curse. 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. He who sins, and the concept there is continues in sin, knows that sin is wrong, but chooses just to continue in sin, chooses not to know God, chooses not to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, he who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. He came to destroy the works of the devil that were brought into humanity in Genesis chapter 3. What Satan has caused, Jesus has come to uncause. He's come to destroy that so that we might have peace with God and that we might have peace with one another in the kingdom of God. He challenged Satan on Satan's own turf, and he sent the devil packing. The temptations. Luke chapter 4, we studied it not too long ago, Sunday morning Bible class. The temptations. 40 days, 40 nights, Jesus is fasting. He's out in the wilderness. He's hungry. Here come the temptations. And he defeated Satan. I don't know if I could have done that. I get an hour past time to eat, and I'm wondering, where's it at? My stomach starts growling. It was 40 days. But see, with each of those temptations, he defeated Satan, the one who came to destroy. He confronted false teaching in the synagogue, and what was the response? Luke chapter 4, verse 18, Luke chapter 4, verse 28, along with it, they plotted to kill him. He's right, we're wrong, but we're not going to do right, so we'll just kill him. We'll get rid of him, and everything will be all right. Well, that's not very good logic, is it? The demons could not withstand his authority. He cast them out. But people, we don't have to worry about that today. Those demons, they're in the bottomless pit, but we've got to worry about the influence that they've left and the influence they have spiritually on us. But he would cast them out. We can cast out demons. We can cast out their authority over us. We can say, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to do what Jesus said to do because I want to be right with God. I want the peace of God in my life. Twice Jesus cleansed the temple of the money changers, the buyers and the sellers, all the livestock that was there. And listen, I've got nothing against livestock, you farmers. But they leave a mess, don't they? They leave a mess where they're at. So with the mess where they're at, that wasn't something that made the temple a nice place. And of what they were doing, the buying and the selling, see, Jesus said, my Father's house is to be a house of prayer. You've made it a den of thieves. And he drove them out once at the beginning of his ministry and then at the end of his ministry. And they couldn't harm him. They tried to have people go and arrest him. They tried to take him. They tried to kill him. They couldn't do it. But then something else happened. And listen to this from John chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. Jesus speaking says, therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that it may be taken, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it up again. This command I have received of my Father. Even when they hung him on the cross, they didn't kill him. He gave his life up for us. And he took it up again. And that leads us to the third promise. And that's the promise of victory. He, speaking of that seed and speaking to Satan, God says, he shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. Take the second one first. You, Satan, are going to bruise his heel. Now, in destroying the works of the devil, in death, Jesus took Satan's deadly poison and in his resurrection now offers us his blood as the antivenom, the cure for sin. Now you think about that for just a moment. That's why when I read from 1 Corinthians 15, when it got down to the sting of death, say, change that to the snake bite. You know what rattlesnakes are, right? I saw a picture of McKenzie with a rattlesnake. I think it was dead. The shovel that was there kind of gave me the indication that it was dead. But we know how dangerous they are. And we know what happens if, when the snake bites, it puts that venom into your system. And you may not die immediately, but there is something that will lead to death unless you get something to take over those effects, destroy those effects of that venom. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he, that's Christ himself, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is, the devil. He came to destroy him who had the power of death, the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. And see, it's just not the fear of death what really should grab our attention is the fear of eternal death. Eternal death, separated from God for eternity in hell, because we refuse to know God and obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. When a sinner believes and obeys the gospel, here's what happens. God the Father delivers us, or delivers him, from the power of darkness and conveys him into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Colossians chapter 1, verse 13, 14. That's paraphrased just a little bit. So at one point, because of sin, we were in the devil's kingdom, the world, as the Bible calls it. But because we've obeyed the gospel, we're transferred, translated, delivered. Delivered is that key word. Our deliverer, we're delivered into the kingdom of God's dear Son. But it's through his blood that we have redemption. And as children of God's kingdom, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. We have fellowship with God, but it doesn't end there. We have fellowship with everyone else who has the same fellowship with God. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Christ cleanses us of all sin. How do we explain that? Bear with me for a moment. You've all heard of the man, the doctor, who first came to the United States with Ebola. You heard of that. He was over in Africa, West Africa. He got sick. They brought him over. I said, what are you doing that for? Don't bring it here. Then they brought another person over, and then a man came in that nobody knew had it, and he spread it around. But that first man, that doctor, went to the hospital in Atlanta, and he was treated, and he overcame the illness. He overcame Ebola. And when that second man, or that man came in unexpectedly, he died, and two nurses who were there in Dallas came down with Ebola. Now, you talk about getting a death sentence. What is it, about 60% of people die who get it? You know what they did? The ones whose blood type was the same as the blood type of the doctor who first came here and recovered, they took blood plasma from him and gave it to those nurses and started to cure the disease. How many times have we heard from the Bible, life is in the blood? Life is in the blood. And how many times do we hear that blood is a cleansing agent? And that the blood of Jesus Christ is a cleansing agent for sin and will give us deliverance over sin and death. And that's what we talk about when we talk about the gospel of Jesus Christ. That when we are buried with Jesus Christ in baptism, we contact the blood of Christ. And that blood cleanses us from the poison that Satan has injected into us in the form of sin and death. He takes it away. He takes the corruptible and he can make it incorruptible. That's in the resurrection. But that's a promise that his blood will cleanse us from sin. Initially, the what were they told on the day of Pentecost? Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. If you walk in the light, he is in the light. The blood of Christ continues to cleanse you from all sin. Hey, if you got bitten by a rattlesnake, you want the rattlesnake venom, don't you? Antivenom. You want it. But sin and death has corrupted mankind, and yet we can't get people to desire to have the cleansing that is in the blood of Jesus Christ. What does Paul say? Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where's your sting? Oh, Hades, where's your victory? It's gone for the child of God. It's gone. Our deliverer has given us a victory that was promised way back in the garden. Adam and Eve had to live in the faith that in spite of their sin, in spite of living in a fallen world, and in spite of the curse of physical death, the Lord God would one day restore them and their descendants the right to eat of the tree of life and to live eternally. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. As Ananias told the Apostle Paul, Acts chapter 22 and verse 16, what are you waiting for? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins. Call on the name of the Lord. If you're here this morning and you're subject to the gospel, we give you the opportunity to obey. Repent, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins. Maybe you've done that in the past, but you've kind of forgotten and sin and death has come to rule in your life once again. Our deliverer is there. And all you have to do is confess, repent, seek the prayers of your brothers and sisters in Christ to bring you back into that right relationship with God. If you have need, please come. Take a seat here in the front as we stand and sing the invitation song.